10 years ago, a new breed of celebrity was born.
Your best performance could also be your last.
But these weren't the usual suspects.
We lay the foundations for the beast that has become reality television.
They were accidental heroes.
I look like such a tool.
You run, subs.
Let's return to Airport. 12 years ago, the BBC gave a new series a tryout on BBC Two.
Oh, it's a bumpy ride, ladies and gentlemen.
The series was Airport. The ratings were fantastic. It transferred to BBC One, and the cast were instantly famous.
It's Heitel's role, and there you were, staring out of the screen.
When I first saw myself on the old box there, it was traumatic, to say the very least.
A bit self-critical about the way you look, the way your hair looks, and the way you talk, and the way you walk.
My phone rang off the hook, and I thought, oh my word, what have I done?
Here he is.
I didn't expect a reaction to be so big.
People say, hi, Michelle, how are you? I say, oh, hi, fine, thanks. I'm like, who are they?
You and the bloke off the telly.
I think, who's that?
You know they're looking at you because they think they know you, but they don't quite know where they know you from sometimes.
Asking for autographs, one of their pictures taken with you.
Did I go to school with you? You can't just say, no, actually, you know me from TV.
Then I said, what's going on? What are they all looking at? They said, it's you.
And I walked into the terminal that day, and a simple two-second trot from check-in to the first floor took me nearly 45 minutes.
How do they feel more than a decade later?
I had no idea that people would actually be writing about us.
Finding fame, that's a double-edged sword, definitely.
Photographer Russell Clisby has always known which side of the lens he belongs.
It's a thin line between them and us, i.e. press and, well, hunter and the prey.
He and journalist Steve Meller loved the thrill of the chase. In 1998, an all-girl group were going on tour, and they were now one ginger nut short of a picnic.
I seem to spend half my life waiting around, especially for the sort of Spice Girls or individuals as they are now. They were like real big news all the time.
Bye-bye. See you in a minute.
Victoria and Emma Bunton turned up and went one way, but we'd got them sussed where they were.
Baby and Posh were young and naive, and they didn't know Heathrow like Steve did.
They've gone the wrong way, and they think they've just got past us. They're in for a shock in a minute. That's why she gave us a little wave.
They knew it was just a matter of time.
And now they're going to go shopping.
I've got a couple of comments just after check-in from them, so I've got something in my notebook, which is what I wanted.
You're looking forward to the tour?
Yeah.
How's it going to go? There's only four of you now.
Really excited.
They'd tracked down Baby and Posh. Now, could they catch up with Scary?
Sitting round the corner, sitting down near Costa Coffee.
Thanks.
The scariest thing about this Spice Girl was her boyfriend.
He's got her back to you. She is the unfriendly Spice today.
I think there's a husband-to-be at the time, a guy called Jimmy Golzo, and he was standing there trying to look all menacing, and we just stood there and took the mickey out of him, basically.
I think he wants to be in the picture.
Her boyfriend came up and said, why have you got the cameras here? And you know, we politely informed him we weren't filming him or her, they were filming Steve and I. And he had this real look of indignance on his face.
Well, we just wait for him to come down, see him go on board. I mean, got really what I want. I've actually managed to get a couple of quotes out of them, all be a bit banal, but we've actually got something. So, and it's three Spice Girls fly off to the US tour with, you know, it's going to be wicked, as Victoria said.
Now they needed a good photo.
Do you think you could have taken them down another way?
They could have taken them down gate 6 and underneath, yeah.
We were going to have another go at them in the departure lounge, so we went through the departure lounge and waited for them, and then it's like they'd been beamed up. They just vanished.
Anything that could have happened is a shortcut through the toilets, right out to the gate. But I can't see that they would run them through there.
Like the toilets?
Yeah, I mean, that's the only way they could actually get through. Yeah,
that would give some guy a nice surprise, wouldn't it? Standing there and there's a Spice Girl going past.
That's more George Michael style.
Yeah. Oh, I'm glad you said that.
Very good, boys. Very good. Our airport staff were now so well known they were becoming more famous than the celebrities they were there to serve.
I was walking up with a couple of passengers and everybody was coming up and saying to me, oh, can we have your autograph, la la la, not a problem. And standing right next to me was Jean-Claude Van Damme, getting very indignant that no one was asking him for his autograph, and he actually asked who the hell I thought I was. And I just looked and I said, just a bloke doing his job, mate.
Others wanted a piece of the action.
And it's strange because you also used to get the celebrities, some of the celebrities coming up to you and saying, when am I going to be on it?
The show was so popular that daytime television transmitted a one-off special, A Morning with Airport.
Like that!
You suddenly found yourself being catapulted into the role of sort of minor celebrity.
The hack and the pap. First.
Thank you, Gabby.
No, Russell and Steve, welcome. You've sort of swapped places now with Posh and Bex, haven't you? Because everybody's chasing you down the airport. Oh, hello, can I have your autograph?
We can't hide and jump out on people anymore.
I had a queue of about six children lining up at an information desk the other day just to get my autograph, so it's really weird.
Oh, Anita, it's a lovely room.
They were all getting attention, yes? But one of them really lapped it up.
Jeremy.
Well, yes, I'm back here at Heathrow. Where am I sitting? So much has changed in our lives since this started, hasn't it?
Jeremy had perfected the three basic presenting skills. Talking about anything for extended periods of time.
Don't turn up in your little carpet slippers or with nothing on your feet at all.
Ignoring your interviewees.
From the other side, you know.
That's amazing. Now, the thing to remember is, guys...
And wearing a very bright shirt.
Way to spend the morning.
The best, I'd say, wouldn't you?
Jeremy's potential had been spotted immediately.
OK, Jeremy, this is the... 747-400 briefing room here.
He was often dragged away from his day job as Aeroflot supervisor and asked to perform.
Jeremy loves all the attention. He loves being in front of cameras. So he had a great time. So
that might be more fun, though.
Heavy crew, that's me. I'm a heavy crew member.
He had this camp-type personality, you know, and he was a real sort of, here I am, look at me.
On this occasion, he was trying his hand in a jumbo jet flight simulator. But he could talk better than he could fly.
Oh, it's a bumpy ride, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome aboard this ride of your life.
Put a camera on him, and there he was, bang, 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 like bouncing around the television set.
Oh, I'm getting rather shudder, because I need more power. Ladies and gentlemen, my sincere apologies.
I'd never really sort of thought I was as gregarious as I was. You know, I like having fun.
Oh my God, there was something at me
that
there.
That was terrible.
That was very close. Oh, my Lord. Look, I need to be going the other way. Silly ass. Securely fast.
Would you put your life in this man's hands?
With those bloody trolleys. Put the trolleys away, girls. No need to work now, because you've got Captain Death here.
Christ,
we're very low.
Two mile terrain.
I can't hear.
You know those pilots, those jet jockeys, they sit there like, you know, not much to do for hours on end, and then suddenly it all kicks off when you're coming into land. Most dangerous part of any flight, landing.
Sink rate.
Oh, mother.
Right, first thrust, Jeremy.
Jeremy was a natural entertainer. It was clear he needed the right vehicle for his talent.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to San Francisco.
You could see he would go on to do other stuff, and sure enough, he did.
So the holiday program was the perfect launch pad for Jeremy's TV career.
Oh, I love Kenya. You know, I was lucky enough to be dispatched by the holiday team to go to Kenya to do a report on a safari.
No, surely not. What am I supposed to do?
I love that place so much. I fell in love with the Maasai tribe. What an amazing bunch of people.
This is where they keep their cattle.
Right.
And these are the houses that are built by ladies.
The ladies build all the houses?
Yes.
Inside. What do you men do?
We eat. Drink beer.
Drink beer, eat.
Make clubs.
I love making clubs.
Yeah.
I said, we're going up in this balloon. We're gonna fly across the Mara And look at all the animals from... Oh, no, we are not in this. This is dangerous.
Maasai warrior number one, John, it's his first time in a balloon, and he was very nervous down there. And he was saying, are you not frightened? And he's had us running round after lions all week. Haven't you?
I've never been on this.
Are you enjoying it so far?
Ah, it's beautiful. Beautiful. I like it. I'll come next time.
What an amazing country.
So after holiday, the sky was the limit. Jeremy's exuberance secured him a place on the TV merry-go-round.
From there, things developed.
It's Jeremy Spake!
Jeremy Spake!
Jeremy Spake!
Take a look at this. Now behave yourselves. Come on, what the hell are you doing?
As you watch the benches filling and see your
buzzer? Certainly not, just completely mad, I think, is the answer to that question. You've got to bring a little winter warmer with you. I brought my Russian cook's hat with me. If you find yourself being offered the opportunity to be in, be yourself.
General, может быть маршал, да? Не маршал. По-моему, маршал, может быть, да? Мастер?
Jeremy was a natural. The daytime whirlwind was followed by some more serious television. Children's Hospital from St. Petersburg touched people's hearts.
100 years ago, this was built as an orphanage. Today, it's home to the St. Petersburg Regional Children's Hospital.
The response from that programme was phenomenal. Absolute, to the point where we actually could not cope with the volume of mail coming in.
Ты не хочешь есть? Только чай, да?
Hospital food here is free, although they have to try and provide a balanced diet on just 30p a day per child. It means they're unable to give them fresh fruits and they don't really get any treats. Some of the food's quite simple, although it does seem to go down quite well.
Sometimes telly is wonderful. It can do brilliant things and show people the reality of where life is and what we need to do to make it more human to be here. So thumbs up for that.
Back at Heathrow, Michelle had a leading role to play in an important celebration. As terminal manager, it was her job to make people aware of Remembrance Day.
I don't believe this. 2 minute silence airport-wide is such a difficult thing to do.
Michelle's first London Remembrance Day will certainly be remembered, for the wrong reasons.
OK.
First, find the correct sound effect.
12 o'clock. Oh, I see, got to take off one. Take off the last chime.
Next, ensure all technical facilities are operational.
Oh, this is a bit temperamental. The connection's a bit loose, I think.
Then run a test. And maybe don't use the Big Ben chime for the trial run.
We can't all be in here. The bing bong's going off early. They thought it was a 2 minute silence already gone, but that was just me testing it, see if it worked. Fine, yes, fine, fine. Yes, I heard that. Yes.
Next, make some last minute script changes.
For 2 minutes, we've asked for 2 minutes.
Add a generous dose of confusion.
Is that the middle bit or the first bit? What's that?
I think the CD player is still on.
And you've done it.
Oh. Usually everybody stands silent and it's an amazing experience because check-in staff will stand behind their desks and the whole terminal just goes still. It's like something stopped in time. May we have your attention, please? This is a special announcement.
Success! Silence is golden.
I messed up with the bing bongs a little bit, but we got there, just about got there.
From bing bong to Hong Kong. Anita Newcourt never sought celebrity. As manager of the Royal Suite, she was happier welcoming the real deal. In 1997, she waved off a clutch of dignitaries to Hong Kong, who were giving it back to the locals.
Weldon and his wife are coming. It's a bit like the who's who here tonight.
It was chock-a-block full of prime ministers, ex-prime ministers, members of the royal family, governors and ex-governors of Hong Kong, all going out to witness the handover back to the Chinese.
Welcome back to the Royal Suite. So nice to have you back. We're just compiling a list of signatures of the people who are going on this historic flight. I hope you don't mind either now or later. Just on this page here, sir, please. Thank you.
But the main VIP of the day was just about to arrive.
Wonderful.
And he's one of Anita's heroes.
The Prince of Wales is just about to arrive. He is going to board the aircraft first, and we're going to board everybody else after him, because he's early.
The Prince of Wales was the representative of Her Majesty. I was wearing my Army Air Corps Eagle, which is the Army Air Corps is my regiment in my territorial army duties. And he noticed it, which is great because he is our Colonel in Chief, and he commented on it.
Your Highness, I bought my Army Air Corps Eagle just to see you, just to make it fly. Thank you, sir.
Where's the
That was just a nice little link to have with him, a personal link between him and I, if you can be personal with the Prince of Wales.
Having a link with the great and good was enough for Anita. But another airport star was busy becoming TV royalty himself. Until 1999, Jeremy had juggled his Aeroflot job with the media work. But something had to give.
I took the very, very difficult decision to leave Heathrow and Aeroflot behind.
Jeremy's experience with nightmare passengers qualified him for his first solo presenting gig, the toughest job in Britain.
Do I shake your hand or not? Possibly not.
No, forget it. Bye.
Probably one of the most unpleasant things I've had to do.
Strangely enough, his worst experience wasn't cleaning portaloos or stroking people's feet, but going on holiday.
The most hideous film of my life, that holiday rep. Oh, I hated that film. Where did I end up? With a load of prepubescent youths in Tenerife, with what can only be described, and God love Andy, the maddest, maddest holiday rep I have ever met in my life.
Okay then, what are we going to be doing now? We're going to be taking you all up to Mutiny on the Bounty. Are you all ready to rock? Are you all ready to drink lots of drink?
Yeah,
the night's not over yet, man. We're just starting.
Oh, behave yourself. It's time to go to bed.
I wanted to go to bed
at 9 o'clock.
Right, make your way straight on, Jeremy. Let's go. Let's go.
Apparently, I'm supposed to be loving it, loving it, loving it. Like I don't think
there was this very famous song at the time. We're loving it, loving it, loving it. And I'm sitting there and I'm going, yeah, like a hole in the head.
Unfortunately, there were others who weren't loving it too.
Oh, there were so many reviews in the papers.
I was forced last night to endure the full 30 noxious minutes of toughest job in Britain. Ms. Spake continues to pursue her career as a TV presenter, television's very own human paperweight, Jeremy Spake.
I mean, there are people out there that say I was talentless. I never wanted to be in telly, and that's the bit that they need to remember.
And it wasn't just Jeremy getting the bad press.
Michelle has a voice that emanates the sound of Concord. That was okay, at least I could be heard in check-in. Bring this queue round. Can you bring this queue round, please?
I had quite a lot of criticism in newspapers for being bossy, pretentious.
Michelle could run the country single-handed, albeit one you wouldn't want to live in. Oh, I was quite chuffed with that.
Make sure that there are no sort of out-of-date lollipop signs, etc., and everything's as it should be.
Yeah, copy that.
Thank you. Oh, Bebo!
As we all know, television's a very fickle business. You know, today's flavour is tomorrow's bad taste.
When you're looking to resurrect your career, often the charity gig is the last chance saloon.
The Hollywood Greats.
Ladies and gentlemen, and Jeremy found the perfect partner for Children in Need.
Vanessa Feltz and Jeremy Spake. leaving our studio behind, and their careers, I suspect, Vanessa and Jeremy. Making way for the...
That was in 2000. But even today, you can't keep our airport heroes out of the limelight. Who knows what tomorrow will bring. 12 years after airport began, Steve Meller is still resident journo at Heathrow, but his mind is on other things.
I spend an awful lot of time wandering the corridors of Heathrow looking for stories, and day after day sometimes, you know, you come out empty-handed. So what I think I'd like to do now is to do something else, lead a new challenge.
And music's the one thing that rocks his boat.
It's a hobby. If I could turn that hobby into a job or a career or something, it's something I'd like to do, but I don't know, maybe I've left it too late.
Tonight, Steve's son has invited him on stage for a live gig.
So hopefully it'll go down well. And I'm not thrown out the door.
How are you doing?
His old mate and partner in crime, Russell, is there to support him.
It's like the first time I've ever seen the guy play. Ever. I've known for 28 years and I've never heard him.
I think when I walk out on the stage, I'll be feeling pretty nervous. Mainly it's the step into the unknown, because we wouldn't have rehearsed the song before. And it always goes through your mind, what if something goes horribly wrong?
As the time draws near, Steve's getting uptight, but Russell's getting down. Can Steve perform anywhere near as well as Russell?
Okay, guys, we've got a special guest get out now.
Will he rock like Led Zeppelin or sink like a lead balloon? It's rock and roll! Just like true rock and roll, you can't really hear a word, but the crowd are loving it. If opportunity knocked, Russell would be sad to see his old pal go.
I don't think he should leave Heathrow. I hope he doesn't. I hope he just writes things for other people and carries on working with us. He's a mate.
Michelle still works at Heathrow, but in the control room of Terminal 3, and she no longer has to deal with passengers. In fact, she prefers communicating with a different species entirely.
I'm going to see Tipsy, my sister's dog, or my sister's son's dog. She's a poppet. She's a bit schizo, but she's a sweetie. Hello, Tipsy. Hello. Hello, sweetheart.
Michelle has completed an animal communication course, so now it's time to put her skills to the test.
High five. Good girl. Good girl. Well, that's amazing. I do high five, but without saying it, I just thought to her, I thought to her, do high five, and she did it. That's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. You're a clever girl.
Jeremy's TV career may not have lasted, but his values haven't changed.
Go back and look at what it was really about. It was about people, and everything I ever did was about ordinary people doing their thing.
Today is no different. Jeremy is still involved in charity work.
Head out on the highway.
I absolutely love doing these events. They kind of make the whole celebrity thing worthwhile.
He's patron of the Devon Air Ambulance, so he's dropping in on some bikers to collect some money they've raised.
Oh, that is absolutely fantastic. Well done, everybody!
Fantastic.
If there's one thing to come out of airport that to me makes the whole thing worthwhile, it's being able to lend my name and my support to things that I'm very passionate about, and this I am very passionate about.
So in 4 years you've raised over £100,000 for the air ambulance. Give yourselves a round of applause.
His fame isn't what it used to be.
Right, so defibrillation.
Defibrillation!
But Jeremy still generates enough attention to help out here and there.
Keep up the hard work,
we'll try
for us,
to.
Yeah.
I've never met anybody famous before.
Have you not?
If you could do it for Stephanie, I'd appreciate
Stephanie.
It, please.
Finding fame, you know, I think that's a double-edged sword, definitely. People acknowledging and respecting and liking what they saw, that was definitely worth it. The fickle nature of television is really very unpleasant. Being famous, it isn't all it's cracked up to be. It was almost like it went past in the blink of an eye.
For all our airport stars, TV fame may have come and gone, but one thing remains. Heathrow is still a powerful lure for them all.
Working at the airport is a permanent buzz. I don't think there's anywhere better in the world to people watch. You can just sit down there and watch all these different kinds of people going past. And it's a bizarre place. And I like it, I mean, love it.
For Anita, the filming was a welcome diversion, but Heathrow is where her heart is.
I really enjoyed being in front of the camera. Who wouldn't, all that attention? But I do have to concentrate on my career and my job, which is running the VIP suites at Heathrow.
Michelle also loves Heathrow, but does have one or two regrets.
If after airport I could have had a TV career, yes, it would have been nice, because, I mean, I would have loved Judith Chalmers' job. But that doesn't happen 24/7.
Steve might be aiming for rock stardom, but how does he think he'll be remembered?
Oh, I'm the man off the telly, and I think that's going to be written on my gravestone. Here lies the man off the telly.
And dear old Jeremy, how does it feel to be back today?
It's actually quite nice to be back, to be honest, because this is home. This is Terminal 2. And it hasn't actually changed a great deal up here over 10 years.
The reality is that there's not a day goes by where I don't regret leaving Aeroflot. You know, they were magical times.
Gabby's actually been here for 20 years.
Oh, I miss you.
So I can walk through here and smile at people I've known for 20 years and they're still here smiling. Bless them.
Does he wish it had all been different?
Airport definitely changed my life. Whether I think it was for the good or the bad, you know, the jury's out, because I think that had I really understood the power of what was about to unfold, I may have done things differently.
Next time, we return to Castaway 2000.
It seemed like we were in prison.
36 people attempt to live on a remote Scottish island for a whole year.
We wanted the real Castaway experience.
Expect rows, harsh conditions, and the most dramatic exit from a reality show ever.
My intention was to get off Tannansea and then do a runner.